Blackstone Audio presents The Politically Incorrect Guide to Jihad by William Kilpatrick. This book is read by John Pruden. To the victims of jihad and to the brave souls who resist it. Introduction. The Untold Story of Our Time. The resurgence of Islam is the biggest story of our time, and the primary means by which Islam expands is jihad. Yet few people understand jihad because a politically correct fog has shrouded the topic from honest discussion. That makes the story of Islamic jihad not only a big story, but also one that's never fully been told. Thus, many in the West still labor under the delusion that jihad is an interior spiritual struggle. Many more have swallowed the establishment line that jihad violence has nothing to do with Islam. Still others cling to the notion that our real enemy is not Islamic jihad, but a mysterious global outbreak of violent extremism. The politically correct portrayal of jihad has lulled the Western world into complacency and left it unprepared for the rapid advance of militant Islamic groups such as ISIS, Boko Haram, and Al-Shabaab. Poorly informed Western citizens were likewise unprepared for the sudden proliferation of lone wolf jihadists. Equally important, few are aware that another form of jihad, stealth jihad, can disable our cultural defenses from within while simultaneously providing an environment in which homegrown terrorists can flourish. Jihad today is particularly insidious because much of it is being fought as a culture war. While focusing on the hot war of battlefield jihad, we tend to ignore the cold war of stealth or cultural jihad. Yet, at least in the West, it is the main front, and ironically, the stealth jihadists have built on the victories of the secular and leftist culture warriors. For example, they benefit from the rules of political correctness laid down by their counterparts on the left. Thus, any attempt at analyzing or explaining Islam from a non-Islamic perspective is met with cries of bigotry and Islamophobia. Jihad is not just hooded terrorists brandishing AK-47s ready to kill and die for Allah. True, rampant persecution of Christians and other minorities in the Middle East and parts of Africa has reached a level of butchery seldom seen in history. But if you're only paying attention to the headlines about beheadings and sex slavery in Iraq and Syria, you may be missing the larger picture. Sometimes major changes are best captured in stories that don't make waves. It's a good bet you haven't heard that Sweden now has the second highest incidence of rape in the world, behind only Lesotho. After accepting more than 100,000 Muslim immigrants into its population of less than 10 million. To be fair, most Swedes won't find that item in their newspapers either. They know what's happening through word of mouth. But the media don't want to acknowledge that Sweden's experiment in multiculturalism has failed. In other words, the problem we face is much greater than ISIS. The Islamic State and similar groups are only the sharp tip of a very large iceberg called Islam. We're not supposed to say that, of course. We're told that Islam is a religion of peace, and everyone from prime ministers to primetime journalists assures us that violent jihad has nothing to do with Islam. One of the chief aims of the Islamist culture warriors is to convince us that we must not draw any connection between violent jihad and Islam, and they have been remarkably successful in doing so. It now appears that the Bush administration was the victim of just such an influence operation by the Saudis and the Muslim Brotherhood. The tiny minority of extremists, we were assured, had nothing to do with Islam, because as President Bush took pains to instruct us on numerous occasions, Islam means peace. And if President Bush was taken in, the Obama administration seems to have been all in from the start. Cultural jihadists have been appointed to important government positions, and stealth jihad organizations such as the Council on American Islamic Relations, CARE, the Islamic Society of North America, ISNA, and the Muslim American Society, MASS, have been given virtual veto power over national security initiatives. In response to the black flag of jihad, the government and media elites of the Western world have raised the white flag of political correctness and appeasement. Although the history of Islam and the history of jihad are intertwined, the mainstream opinion makers have decided it's better that you don't know. Their hope is that by making soothing sounds about Islam, we can appease angry Muslims and convince the others to adopt a more moderate form of Islam. But Islam is not inherently a moderate religion. ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and Boko Haram are heirs of a tradition that goes all the way back to Muhammad. That's not to say that every Muslim is a terrorist in waiting. Fortunately, a great many Muslims ignore the harsher mandates of their faith. Islam itself, however, was founded in militancy and spread by violence. The jihad is on the rise again, but that's only because traditional Islam, the Islam of Muhammad, is undergoing a resurgence. The politically correct crowd likes to say that ISIS and similar groups are un-Islamic, but if jihad, sex slavery, and beheadings are un-Islamic, then Muhammad himself was un-Islamic. The Sirah, Life of Muhammad, is mostly devoted to descriptions of raids, battles, distribution of booty, slave trading, and yes, beheadings. One suspects that Muhammad would have felt quite at home among today's jihad warriors. The black flag that ISIS and other jihadis fly is itself a testimony to the Islamic nature of the terrorist organizations. One might expect that the white inscription on it says something to the effect of, "Kill all you meet," but what it actually says is, "There is no God but God, and Muhammad is the messenger of God." If you're a Muslim, that's non-controversial. Those are the words of the Shahada, the Islamic profession of faith. Recitation of the Shahada is the first of the five pillars of Islam, and it is the main component of the five times daily call to prayer. Typically, the words of the Shahada are the first words a newborn Muslim child hears whispered into his ears. As for the now familiar phrase, Allahu Akbar, that too is part of the daily routine. A devout Muslim who says his prayers faithfully will repeat the words 25 times per day, every day. Allahu Akbar means God is greater or greatest. Translated into the language of youth, it means, "My God can beat up your God." This is the appeal of Islam to young men, and it helps to explain why groups such as ISIS have no trouble finding recruits. Young men like to be on the winning side. They decidedly do not like being losers. Interestingly,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.